Thank you, everyone, for joining the session on groundwater resources. We have only two speakers in this session. We have Kris, who is currently with UNICEF in Somaliland, and we have Moti, who's coming to us from Nepal, so quite disparate parts of the world. Thank you very much for your talks today and agreeing to be part of this session. Since just to let everyone know, what I'm thinking of doing, depending on how the questions are going, since we don't have a third speaker, after the normal Moti question period is over, then I'll open up the session for questions to both speakers if there's many more things that people wish to discuss. If not, then we'll close the session down. So we'll just play that by ear and see how things go, okay? So let me start our first talk by Kris, and this is on enhancing climate resilience communities in the Horn of Africa, groundwater management and strategies for drought management. Okay, I shall start the presentation now.
Hello, my name is Kris Cahyanto, and today I would like to present you my presentation with the title Enhancing Climate Resilience Communities in the Horn of Africa, Groundwaters and Strategies for Drought Management. The presentation will be divided into six parts. I will start this presentation with introduction of the study, continue with the study area, methods, result and discussion, continue with the conclusion of the study, and some references that I used to develop this presentation. As an introduction, I would like to remind you that the provision of safe drinking water in arid and semi-arid regions remains a huge challenge, and this is the real case in Somalia. Prolonged drought and famine have been declared in 1991 and 2012. Moreover, desert, locust infestations, COVID-19 global pandemics, conflict, and poverty have contributed to acute food insecurity and child malnutrition. Over 106,000 cases of moderate acute malnutrition and over 25,000 severe acute malnutrition were recorded in 2020. To build the resilience of the community in the Horn of Africa, there's an urgent need to reduce the vulnerability of the community. The focus of the study will be done in Somaliland, a self-declared state in the Horn of Africa. It has population approximately 4 million people, which 610 individuals are considered IDP, or internally displaced people. It's located in arid and semi-arid area with precipitation less than 450 millimeters per year. It has soil characteristics dominated by shallow sandy area and layers of limestone in many parts of the location. This study attempts to analyze drought, water resources situation in Somaliland, and further mitigation strategies. To do this study, analysis on the existing surface water system will be done, followed by the analysis on the groundwater resources and analysis using remote sensing technology, in particular, the utilization of synthetic aperture radar and multispectral instruments. Let's move to the next session on the result and discussion of the study. I will start with the analysis on the freshwater resources in Somaliland. To do this analysis, I used 26 Sentinel-2 multispectral images between 1st of July 2020 to 30 October 2020. In this analysis, two techniques were used. The first one is normalized drift water index, or NDWI, and the second method is normalized drift vegetation index, or NDVI. With these two techniques, rapid identification of freshwater bodies can be observed both during the dry season period and wet season period. Let's analyze the situation of rainwater harvesting system and challenges in Somaliland. Table 1. Indicate evaporation rate by region in millimeter per day. In arid and semi-arid region, in the warm climate, it is estimated that the evaporation rate will be between 6 to 8 millimeter per day. Table 2 indicates seepage losses in millimeter per day. In sandy soil types, it is estimated that the seepage losses will be between 25 to 250 millimeter per day. Therefore, to develop proper rainwater harvesting system, it is very important to minimize any seepage losses and to minimize higher evaporation rate. Let's move to the next analysis on groundwater situation in Somaliland. Following WASC cluster data in 2020, there are 444 functioning boreholes, 141 non-functioning boreholes, and 44 abandoned boreholes. These 44 boreholes were abandoned due to collapsings, cloggings, and some boreholes were filled with sand. There were also some issues regarding water quality, for example, salinity and hardness of water. Some boreholes were also reported that the placement of screens are not tapping the right aquifer. These 141 boreholes were non-functioning due to some mechanical and electrical issue, including some managements and staffing, including some issue regarding the ownership of the borehole. From this map, you can also see that actually most of the abandoned boreholes are also located in the area where majority of the boreholes are actually functioning. Let's move to the drought response and water tracking during dry season period. Most of fresh water and surface water resources are dry during the peak of dry season period, and the majority of water tracking relies on groundwater resources. There are large quantity of water were distributed for a large number of population over a long distance, and then it also creates some issue in terms of water quality monitorings. Furthermore, there's also high variety in terms of water demands and water prices during the dry season period. For example, to achieve SPIR key indicators of 15 liters per person per day, approximately it will cost $100,000 for 13,000 people per month. And then during the dry season period, some of the water prices is estimated at $3.5 per barrel, or it's equal to $17.5 per meter cubic. As a comparison of water prices in other large cities, for example, in London, the water is estimated at 1.4 pounds per meter cubic, 2.2 euro per meter cubic in Berlin, $1 per meter cubic in Jakarta, and $1.1 per meter cubic in Singapore. Therefore, from this price comparison, we can also see that actually the prices of water in Somaliland is extremely expensive, especially during the dry season period. To analyze the potential of groundwater resources in Somaliland, two Sentinel-1 synthetic aperture radars will be used. The first Sentinel-1 synthetic aperture radar was taken on 1st January 2020, and the second synthetic aperture radar was taken on 15 April 2021. The analysis of these two Sentinel-1 synthetic aperture radars indicates surface deformation between 3 mm to 37 mm and over 44 mm to 54 mm in some area, as indicated with the red colors. From this analysis, we can also see that there's a changes in surface vertical deformation and its association with the groundwater changes. If we look into the risk management framework, risk is equal to hazard multiplied by exposure multiplied by vulnerability. Therefore, to reduce the vulnerability of the population, there's a need to build the capacity of the affected population, whether before, during, and after emergencies. There are two measures are proposed. The first one is structural measures, consists of borehole construction, prepositioning of borehole, spare part and equipment, including construction of rainwater harvesting system, which for the non-structural measures consists of regular update on weather forecast, training for borehole operator and technician, groundwater database, water controls, and better water tariff. As a conclusion, there are four takeaway messages from this study. First, surface water management. The study indicates the presence of natural water catchment system, including springs and rainwater harvesting system. However, this system is still under development. With precipitation rate between 400 mm per year up to 400 mm per year, there are opportunity to scale up rainwater catchment system in Somaliland. Second, groundwater resource management. There are large number of functional and non-functional borehole which required regular operation and maintenance. There's a potential for groundwater extraction. Third, remote sensing. The utilization of multispectral instrument and synthetic aperture radar were proven to be efficient in supporting water resource management in Somaliland. Fourth, drought risk management. Major intervention during the dry season period, in particular water tracking, is proven to be extremely expensive and challenging. Therefore, major investment should be addressed to mitigate the risk through various interventions before the crisis. At the end, this is the reference that I used to prepare this presentation and some few resources that I used to support the study. At the end, thank you so much for your attention. Have a nice day.
Okay, thank you very much, Kris. Very interesting presentation. We're available for questions. I'll just ask you one. You said what you're showing signs of significant surface deformations due to groundwater extraction, I presume. So have you looked at any wider water balance study for the groundwater system there? Because I would presume your potential evaporation is very high. And with the amount of water that's been taken out in the dry season, I presume you're taking more out of the groundwater aquifer system than what's going in by natural recharge. So have you sort of looked at that to see what the future sustainability is of the way you're managing that aquifer system?
Oh yeah, thank you. Yeah, it's a very good question, Graham, especially regarding the water balance in Somaliland. Indeed, that the study didn't really calculate the water balance of the overall situation, but somehow in general message that I want to send from this study is that the quantity of water that is coming from the precipitation rate in Somaliland is extremely low. And then on top of that, the precipitation, let's say if we use the precipitation rate, evaporation rate as shown by FAO standard, is also quite high. And we can measure or we can identify that actually the consumption of waters and also the water demand is also quite high. And in terms of the water balance, I would say that almost all the water supply system is relying on groundwater resources at this moment. And again, this is a kind of like a primary water source that is available during the dry season period, and even is also during the rainy season period. And then in terms of the water recharge, this is also one of the things that we are doing now. We're still trying to, let's say, to monitor most of the groundwater status, including the suction or lessen the production of all borehole in Somaliland. But this is a big task at this moment. And at this moment, we're only able to monitor the situations of of the boreholes in one of the region, especially in Baruma. And I will say the study is still ongoing at this moment. Okay. I hope it's answered your question. Yeah.
No, it does. It is a difficult problem. I guess at best you can just sort of get some approximate ideas as to what the state of the water balance is. I mean, to get it accurate is not going to be easy. But I guess you could do some, general calculations on base of what you think the extraction rates are like in different areas and multiply it up by the number of wells. And since you have a rough idea what recharge is going to be like in evaporation, you can sort of get an order of magnitude type idea.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for your advice. I'll consider this estimation for my future study. Thank you. Yeah.
We do have a couple of other questions that have come in by Tiring, what is the average depth of the boreholes in Somaliland now? Do you see the water table going down with lesser recharge? I guess it's linked to
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Thanks, Tiring. And it's good that you are also here and attending this presentation. Yes, so the average of the borehole depth is quite vary from one region to another region. I will say some of the a deep borehole normally is between 400 up to 500 meters depth, And then that mostly located in the area like in Tokder regions, and also in some area in Adal regions. Some area in Harigaisa normally is a little bit shallow, about 200 meters. And then in eastern part of Somaliland, some of the borehole depth between 150 meters up to 200 meters, so it's quite deep. And then in terms of the drawdowns, so yeah, from this, let's say, land subsidence analysis that I did based on this remote sensing data, yeah, it seemed that there is a land subsidence in the area surrounding Harigaisa. And this is also makes sense because most of the Harigaisa population, they rely on the groundwaters. And the largest population in Somaliland is also exists within this region. And based on this study, yeah, we can see that there's an indication of land subsidence, but the quantity is not that much. I think it's still less than 10 meters, for example, in 1 year. Yeah.
Okay, Moti has also posted a question. Are there any climate resilience initiatives to keep the water in the deep bores?
Yes, so there are also some efforts to utilize these existing precipitation, especially during the rainy season period. Some of the activities was trying to, let's say, to develop a rainwater catchments. Locally in Somaliland, they call it a berkat. And I will say that many organizations, they also try to introduce this system. And some of the system is quite simple. They use basically kind of like a concrete system to harvest the water during the rainy season period. And then some organization, also some organization funded by KfW or from the bank, they try to introduce a larger scales with the geomembranes. Some of the system is working well. And yeah, I will say at this moment, we're still trying to scale up this approach. And I will say the challenge for the system is on the operation and maintenance. And this is some of the issue reported by some organization, for example, FAO. For example, when they provide this kind of system to the community, when the geomembrane is leaking or is broken, sometimes it's quite difficult to get the people to fix and to cover the leakages. And this is some of the challenge from this new technology that that tried to be introduced in Somaliland.
Okay. There's a further question from Tyrang. Are there public private public partnership companies still functioning now? He was in Hargeisa, if I pronounced that correctly, in 2011-2012, and the average bore depth was then about 150 meters.
Yes. Thanks, Tyrang. Yeah. So the public-private partnership is working well in Baruma district at this moment, and I think that's the only PPP that is working well in Somalia or even in Somaliland. And I will say, yeah, there's a good effort and result from these PPPs. Especially if we look into the coverage of the drinking water at this moment in Baruma district or Baruma city, it's almost 50% of the population in the urban area, and they can get access to this water piping system and distribution system provided by, let's say, by UNICEF and some other development organization. And then, yeah, we also try to introduce the PPPs in other regions. But at this moment, yeah, the result is not so positive. And most of the system is still being managed by the water utility services, or let's say by the Ministry of Water Resources in this case. Yeah. Over. Yeah.
Okay, probably one last question before we move on to Moti, but it is for Moti as well. He says, it's amazing that in Nepal, the maximum depth people go to is 150 meters, but you're going far deeper there. I guess that's just a function of the climate and geology that's there.
Yes, correct, yeah. Yeah, in some area, the depth of the borehole is between 150 meters up to 200 meters. But in larger part of Somalia, especially like in, again, as mentioned before, in Tokder regions, in Adal, It can go up to 400 meters, 450 meters. And again, the cost to drill this deep borehole is quite expensive. Yeah, I will say the price is also extremely expensive. And this is some of our challenge here.
Okay, thank you. I thought there's quite a few questions still popping along, but maybe we can continue questions to both of you after Moti has done his talk. Okay, so Moti, let's I'll start your talk now. Okay.
Sure. Dear everyone, namaste. Today I am going to share research that was carried in Nepal in two different elevations. The research included two different community status. The one at the lowland was a semi-urban area, and the mid-hills was a rural setup. So welcome to the presentation title is a sanitary risk assessment and quality, water quality of community managed water supplies in the lowland and mid-hills of Nepal. And myself, Moti Poudel from Kathmandu University. This research was carried by a research team that includes the researchers from Kathmandu University and University of Bristol. And the name of the researchers has been listed in the presentation slides. So if we talk about the water quality and the water services, GMP has defined water services or the water is, water services refers to the accessibility, availability, and quality of main sources used by households for drinking, cooking, personal hygiene, and other domestic uses. A study done in Nepal has shown that the total water supply coverage in 2016 was 87%, and that increased to 90% at present. Similarly, the basic sanitation coverage in Nepal is 99%. However, if we talk about the functionality of the schemes, the only 25.4% has been found functional, and whereas 74.6% requires any sort of maintenance or the repair. The fact and the figures that has been that we have found is that 0.9% of those 74.6% are now out of order and they cannot give the services as a water supply system. And talking about the methodology of this research, this study includes the scores for of sanitary inspections, which was done with the help of WEDC standard field assessment tools, and the quantitative data of E. coli contaminations observed after the on-site analysis of water samples was carried. And similarly, the WSO fecal indicator bacteria, FIB index, to quantify the scheme functionality was assessed. Similarly, two different meteorological stations were installed on our two different research sites, and the data was retrieved from there to compare the data of meteorological data and E. coli data. And while we can say that the water quality was compared scores of low to high, that was even linked with the WSO risk category assessment tool. And the sanitary risk score for tube wells, protected springs with pipe, mechanized deep borings, spring source with pipe were categorized after scoring these scores, and the ranges was from low to very high. This study was carried in Nepal from December 2019 to July 2021. So, and this research includes both low and the lowland area with the average elevation of 300 meters above sea levels, and the mid-hills of Nepal with maximum elevations. We came for the research with 3,000 meters above sea level. This research includes 16 spring sources connected with the piped distribution system, 5 protected sources with protected spring systems, but with no any connected pipe distribution systems. Similarly, 11 different deep borings that were connected to the groundwater were sampled for this research. 10 different hand pumps were sampled for this research, and all these water sources are used for the sampling, were all used for the drinking purposes. Talking about the results and discussions, all the physical parameters like pH, temperature, turbidity, electronic conductivity, and TDS, total dissolved solutes, were found as per the Nepal's drinking water quality standards provided in 2005. While if we talk about the equally contaminations, it was done through the membrane filtration methods, and the results was taken by coliform forming unit per 100 ml. And we can see that tubules were found more contaminated during autumn, rainy, and least in winter, while winter and autumn had the highest contaminations on spring sources with pipe systems. Comparatively, deep borings were found less contaminated, but still contamination was high during autumns. All the samples in winter, rainy, and autumn was found contaminated in spring sources, which has no any pipe connections. While we talk about the mid-hills or in the upper elevations, winter had a higher percentage of microbial contaminations in protected spring sources that are even connected with the pipe networks. And all the 100% samples collected from the spring source that has no any pipe connections were found 100% contaminated with E. coli. We cross-tabbed the results during of the both the lands, both the lowland and the mid-hills. We can see that autumn has the highest rate of contaminations in lowland, and winter has the highest contamination rate in mid-hills of Nepal. If we cross-tab the sanitary inspection scores and microbial contaminations for tubules data, we can see that 14% of tubules lies at the high risk category of FIV-WHO category and needs an urgent actions to improve the quality, while 86% lies at the intermediate and low action priority. 6% of the deep borings needs an urgent action and lies at very high risk zone of sanitary scores. The major findings of this research shows that all the 100% of the spring sources that have no any pipe connections needs an urgent actions to improve the services, as the sources lie with the very high risk scores during sanitary risk assessment. And the last type of water sources that had the good pipe systems connected to the source, we found 50% in urgent actions required maintenance zone, and 50% at low action priority with low sanitary scores. This research, as I said earlier, we have tried to find a correlation between precipitation patterns and the water quality. However, for this research, we studied two different meteorological institutions on lowland and the mid-hills of Nepal. And after the data, we correlated after the sampling hours, before 24 hours and before 48 hours, we could not find any significant correlations between the water samples and precipitation patterns. Similarly, we did try to find any correlations between the sanitary inspection scores and E. coli contaminations, and say that we found significant correlations between the exposed pipes and which were leakings on the surface, where correlates were found significant correlations to E. coli contaminations. Coming to the conclusions, this research shows that sanitary inspection forms are the standard tools that helps to figure the sanitary status of sources, and even that can guide us for the improvement of the sources. We can see that the water samples at the lowland was found more contaminated during the autumn seasons, while in winter, at mid-hills. So as we could not see any significant correlations between precipitations and microbials water quality. Also, the spring source with no pipelines and layers and urgent actions to improve the. And these are the references that we have researched. And my special acknowledgments to supervisors, community at research area. Greatest thanks to University of Bristol for financial support and Kathmandu University is a local research partner. All the laboratory assistance was provided by Aquatic Ecology Center at Kathmandu, Nepal. And thank you for your kind attention, for your time over me. I'd like to appreciate for your queries, and I'm really happy to answer your questions. Thank you, everyone. Namaste.
Thank you, Moti. Thank you very much. We have a question already in the chat box, and it says, what have been the actions taken to solve these water quality issues, and by who?
Actually, am I audible, sir? Hello?
Sorry?
Am I audible?
Yes. Yes.
All these research was done in a water supply systems that has been like run by the community peoples themselves, where the country Nepal people, the national level support, the government of Nepal is also providing support, and some of them are even self-sufficient to run their schemes, like they have a certain source of income to run the scheme. So most of these source have received some kinds of support from either from government or from the local people who have been depending upon the water.
Okay. Could I ask you a question? What have you identified what the source of it is? If there's no correlation between precipitation and E. coli content, so that suggests it's not coming from any surface runoff that's carrying, you know, from animals walking around near the well and defecating, and then, you know, runoff causing contaminated water going into the well. So where is it coming from? Is it a broader issue with the groundwater being contaminated, or what? I mean, have you identified what the main source is?
I'm sorry, sir. Like, you're concerned that the precipitations and the relations of the water quality?
You said there's no correlation there. So yeah. One presumes, therefore, often there is a correlation because precipitation causes surface runoff, which then carries E. coli into the well.
We were also wondering that we are expecting some correlations from E. coli and water quality, but maybe the main reason that these sources are out of E. coli because they have like some types of protections on the sources, like people have already started protecting the source. The next thing is that like most of the sources here are the deep borings and the tube wells, so maybe those are safe from the E. coli, I believe so.
Okay, Chris has a comment here. He's asking, can you explain the bit on seasonal degradation of water quality? So what is the cause and migration or mitigation? So I guess all comes down to, have you been able to identify where the source is and what have you been able to, therefore, can you do about it?
Yes, sir. Actually, if we see these research locations in Nepal, in Tarai regions, all of the sources were groundwater, and when we go in the medials, it was on the spring sources. And most of the time we have found that our research has shown the water quality has been degraded in the autumn seasons. Maybe the main reason is that due to the limited resource or the limited water from that they have been using the same water for time and again. Maybe the reasons behind that the water is more contaminated during the autumn is like it's mid-winter here. And even that time, the water is freezing in the outside water gets freezing, and the water they have been practicing to use is on the storage water. So maybe due to this, some cross contaminations within the households, maybe one of the reasons that the water is contaminated in the household. While in the sources, like in autumn, like most of the cattle has been left on the jungle area, or like maybe that may be a reason that those animals had been a reason for cross-contaminating the source. And regarding the mitigations, like the only thing is that how community are aware on water quality, and by these results, what we have done is that like we share their results to the community people that see this with the results that you have been dependent on the sources. So if you are not going to protect this water, then this may even hamper you. So they have started themselves forming a committee and preserving the source, and so this is all what they are doing. So.
Okay, thank you. Lucy has a comment here as well. What is your recommendation to prevent the contamination based on the source of the contaminant and the scheme slash technology type, as the vulnerability of different technologies are different from the research?
Exactly, sir. Like in case of Nepal, like rather than the source, the more problem is on the point of use and the water they have been using. And the infrastructures, if you look, they literally get like managed because they just think that the water is free of the services and they are getting the water. So my recommendation is that to strengthen the households to like boost up on the local treatments from the on the household area, like either to use boiled water or maybe they can simply use the filtered water. There are some schemes developed by Gorkha Welfare Committee, like GWS, and they have been using the high technology from source to point of use, that they have their own standards. So if we can implement such standard operating procedures of developing new source, then those systems or those processes will help the to minimize the contaminations in the water. Also, the next thing is that if while developing any schemes or the water supply schemes, like if we can involve the community people, they feel that the schemes is for themselves, so that the care and care of the schemes will be more they will provide for them. So I think both going with the technology and including the community, so I think that will be the best way to save the water and to enhance the quality of the water. So.
Okay, Tyring is asking, is the data gained from your research being provided to the government and also UNICEF and WHO to compare with their GAMOP result? If compared, do these results differ from each other?
May I just read this again? Is this data gained from the research we provided? No, actually, we did this research ourselves.
Sorry?
We did this research ourselves, and rather than WHO and UNICEF, it's my personal research and University of Bristol we are working, but we have been sharing these results to WHO Nepal and to DWSSM, who is more concerned for the drinking water. We have been talking with them for the water quality. It's like, these are the problems and this is how we can go in the near future. Is the research area that I have been doing is like in the middle, and less people only visit there. So we have just shared our information to them, but this is all drawn from us. And if compared, do the visits differ from each other, government general? Somehow, yes. Government of Nepal, they have their own mechanisms of collecting the data, but and they lessly do it seasonally. They just go it for the yearly sampling or maybe upon their own schedule, but I have been doing the research on every season, so there is difference in the data collections, and there are slightly difference with what they have shown, because this results has shown that most of the sources are more vulnerable themselves, because of there is no any community to manage over it, and people are taking not that seriously for the water quality. But the government, they mostly look for the services or the schemes they have been taking care for that. That's it.
Okay, Matthew has asked, are there any mechanisms in place for regular monitoring of the water quality? And who could continue it and inform the communities?
Government of Nepal, DWSSEM in Nepal, they have their own way of collecting the data with some online technologies that whenever I test the water quality, I just make an entry over the systems and they have been started getting the data. So we are not with them on this research, but however, there is a mechanism for the water quality monitoring. And also they have recently implemented WSPs and climate resist WSP in the water quality. So they have their own mechanisms of collecting data, but I'm loosely linked with this monitoring and collecting data. So.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm happy to open this up now to, if there are questions to both of our speakers. Whoever it is, just put their name first so we know that the question will be given to the right person. If you want a question for Kris, just start it off with Kris, the word Kris, and Moti, obviously.
I had one question for Kris. Apologies for the background noise. I've got some workmen working nearby. But I had a question for Kris. It's interesting to see your spatial data in terms of the various borehole locations and the functional, non-functional ones, as well as your other data. I wondered if you'd used that spatial data to identify vulnerable areas and kind of produce vulnerability maps in terms of proximity to working boreholes. I know you mentioned a lot of the non-functioning ones are actually very close to functioning ones, and therefore it's less of an issue. I just wondered to the extent to which you'd use that spatial data to kind of perhaps identify key priority areas for operation and maintenance spending, for instance.
So the data that we use, or the data that I used to develop this presentation, was from a Swalim FIO water resources monitoring in 2020, and indeed this data is very useful because we can use it to map out all the water resources that is available in Somaliland. And actually we have also the data of let's say the surface water situation, for example like the dams and breakout, however I didn't put it there. And then this data is also useful because when I put it into this GIS map, I can also combine it with some assessment data done by many of our, let's say, government partners and NGOs partners, especially during the drought season period. And normally during the drought season period, every time there's a data of water scarcity or water trackings, or let's say, a report about the needs for, let's say, emergency water services, then we can also plot it into the map easily. And I will say the challenge is that, the location of this area that required some emergency water truckings or water services normally is always far from the existing boreholes. For example, when I use this map to analyze the location of the emergency affected area, especially drought, sometimes the distance can be vary from 20 to 50 kilometers, and even it's between 50 to 100 kilometers in some area, especially in the area close to the border between Somaliland and Ethiopia. In some location, even the location of this area is closer to Ethiopia rather than some area in Somaliland. So yeah, that's true. The data is being used to map out all these, let's say, crisis affected area, and also to identify the distance in case we want to do a kind of like emergency response or humanitarian water tracking services.
Okay. Itai, did you want to ask your questions?
Yeah. I just want to ask because I've been to two countries. I mean, both Somaliland and also Nepal. So first to Kris, and then after that to Moody. Kris, who are you with right now? Are you with UNICEF or FAO?
I'm with UNICEF.
In Hargeisa.
In Hargeisa, yes. Yesterday, yeah.
So is still Hassan still there?
Yes, Hassan Egal is still here. And then, yeah, the office is new, I will say. It's about 3 kilometers from the city center. And yeah, for other colleagues, for Graham and Tim and Moti, yeah, me and Teh, we used to work together during the Asia tsunami response back in 2005, 2006. So yeah, it's a pleasure to meet you, Teh, I think. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm just surprised that Hassan's still there, despite so many problems. You know what I mean. The thing in the sense of for the borehole and all this, is the Ministry of Water Resources actually taking taking notes and taking the record of what your study for them to actually go forward for the management, or is this 100% still in UNICEF?
Yeah, for this study is done internally within UNICEF, I will say. But of course, yeah, based on this study, yeah, we also presented to, let's say, to our development partners, for example, some other NGOs and organization, for example, like OCHA, and then the GIZ, or German Development Organization, and some other organization who are interested in water sectors. And actually, there are two, let's say, two key messages also here. For example, here, the high dependency on groundwater. I think this is a clear evidence in Somaliland. And then the second one is on the price of water, especially the price of water because of water truckings and the fluctuations of water prices, especially during the transition period, is unbelievable. Because again, as you saw from, as you can see from my presentation, the price of water can be almost 20 times higher than the normal price of water in normal situation.
Yeah, I can understand, because I was there in 2011 on famine. So we worked on there, and I still remember on the time that we set up the water point and asking for those people who are walking into the area, where, I mean, completely on famine. We have to ask them whether they have left any old or children behind. So if they say yes, and then we have to go and send a car to the direction where they're pointing to, and then to find them and then take them back into it. Hopefully they're still alive. I still remember that time. So just giving you some idea that the water resources in Somaliland and Somalia is extremely critical for life on that area. More not only for people but also for their livestock. I have seen that issue. Okay, thank you. Now back to Moti. The question I'm having here is that you're working with the Kathmandu University of Kathmandu, and also the other university, and making this particular water quality survey, and you're assuming they're using WETC or Delagua kit.
Yeah, WETC, sir.
Okay, question I'm having here is, how useful are this particular type of kits in where you are working in, assuming that you will have to take about 24 hours to grow the bacteria, and then after that, how is it that you're able to go back to the community and tell them the result? Because that is actually what my a lot of my problem is that when we actually collecting the water sample, we move to the next way, and then we move over there, and with the terrain in Nepal, as you know of, people pay to come to Nepal, pay a big price to come to Nepal to trek the hill.
Yes,
I'm talking about Himalaya. So so how actually you able to go back to those villages in the short time?
That's a great thing that you have been here and you have done so many things, sir. Thank you so much for your questions. Basically, for the research, I have been using WETC, sir. And while taking the sample and delivering the results to the community, like, we have been collecting the phone calls of the leaders of the water supply systems people. Like, phone number has been collected from those water supply schemes that we have been collecting the samples. The main leaders that we have been contacting them and taking the numbers from them. And after we test, and if we see the water has been contaminated by some E. coli, then we just keep him calling that this is what we have seen on the water, and please pay like some attention on the production of the source. On that way, we have been informing the information to them. The next thing that in every 3 months we have been visiting the same community every year. So the first result, the first data that I collected on the month one has been delivered them on the third month by physically when we go there. But as the time of the sampling, we keep them informing by the phone calls over there, sir. That's how we have been delivering our information to them.
I'm assuming you're taking the reading twice a year?
That no, sir.
Sorry?
I'm sorry, sir. We have been trying to test the water quality in every season. That's in the 4 times per year.
Can you give me the month?
It was only like we go into the Nepali months over here. Like if we go in the midwinter, like it in the Jan February, then every 3 months later, then we keep on visiting there, sir.
Okay, because in the sense of if you're looking at that, there is a very distinctive seasonal change.
Yes.
Especially pre-monsoon and monsoon, right?
Yes, sir.
What will be the in terms of this sort of changes in between the season, how you see the water quality changes? I mean, looking at that one, because I actually did the same type of water quality survey in Nepal as well back in 2000 after the earthquake. So 2014, 15, and 16, I think 17, up to 17 as well. So I'm actually quite familiar with your method. So in the sense of how you see that seasonal change in terms of quality.
Actually, I'm sorry. Yeah, please. Thank you, sir. Most of the literatures that has been covered in Nepal has shown that the water quality has deteriorated in monsoon's time in context of Nepal, and equally has been more contaminated on the household's water samples. Even the recent MICS report delivered by UNICEF have shown that the water quality has been more deteriorated in the point of view or in the household rather than in the sources. It is just the recent findings. And in my research, what I have done is that I have more underground water, and we have found it more safe from the drinking water equally contaminations. And the water supply system, they have been chlorinating the water before they have been delivering to the users. So in the lower land, the water quality is more better. But while we go to the mid hills, that there is no any such treatment methods. Only a few water systems have been using their own way of protecting the source. Maybe they have just a limited way, they have fenced the water sources, and they rarely do treatment at the household. However, despite of all those contexts too, we have found water quality more deteriorated in the autumn season. That was in January and February,
So in a sense, you're looking at autumn season. That means before Dasai. Almost on the peak of the monsoon. Actually, the worst quality. Is that what you're saying? That coincide the diarrhea outbreak and cholera outbreak every year.
Yes, sir.
Is that how you're seeing also?
Oh, yes, sir. Like most of the time, Nepal has faced the diarrheal incidents in the rainy seasons. And those things depends and differs in the location-wise in Nepal, because the research I am carrying is a most touristic place that people have been visiting there. It's like the Annapurna base camp trekking route. So on that area, people are more wise and they have been more careful on treating the water. And those incidents that you have heard about, that the diarrhea incidents that are in the remote place of the Nepal, and still there, these problems are there. So I really appreciate that you have so many of sense over the Nepal, and even you know the best festivals over here. Hence, Dasai, you're right to that extent, sir. Yeah, yes.
Okay, thank you. I don't have any further questions. Back to Graham and Tim.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I mean, it is something for me to catch up and then see how both countries has been
today
developed since I left.
Research that was carried in Nepal in two different.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, that was
what. May I take a few minutes, please?
Yeah.
The main thing that we have like some of the limitations of this research actually, sir, because since the water quality we have found deviated rather than in the monsoon, we have found more water quality deteriorated in the autumn. The main reason might be that I have a full regular sampling plant, but I couldn't do those samplings, or I missed those samplings due to the COVID lockdown. And these are the data that I have presented here, is from those how many times I could visit there, and this study is still going on. So maybe at the end, after I will go and collect the samples again from there, I think we'll come to some more concrete decisions. And I'll be really happy to share all these things, Mr. Thai Ring, sir. If you could just share me your email address, I am really happy to share the results with you.
Yeah, you can actually see my email in the delegate site as well. Okay. And you can forward that. Good for that. Is that your home village near Annapurna circuits, like
Kandruk?
Yes. Is that your home village?
No, sir. I'm from Chiton. It's like Chiton National Park, Sauraha.
Chiton.
I'm from Sauraha, but one of the research area is Chiton and Sauraha area, and the next one is the Kandruk. Up from Kandruk, I start my sampling and I go up to Chomrong, sir. That's up to like 2000.
I know exactly where you are because I've been there. So yeah. So I know approximately how you walk. Yeah, it's a beautiful part of Nepal. Absolutely.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm so happy to hear, and you have done so many things over here. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, best we better bring this session to an end because it's going to be shut down on us very quickly anyway.
Thank you
to both our speakers, Kris and Moti. It's certainly led to quite a lot of discussion, which is very nice to see. And if people wish to continue this discussion afterwards, they can do it in the sort of like the coffee room, or you can do it privately. Thank you very much for those two very enjoyable presentations.